All good? Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Walkersville United Methodist Church as we get together for the first time in our sanctuary for a worship service since March 8th. It's been that long since we've been able to gather in here, but praise be to God that we are able to come and worship together in this space. Just a few things to bring to your attention or as reminders that since we're not able to sing, when the hymns are displayed on the screen, if you'd like to reflect upon the words, or we've been told that you can speak or hum along softly, but all the time wearing your mask, the mask need to be on the entire time that we're here for worship and in the building. And then, excuse me, also, after the service is over, the ushers will direct you in leaving, and we encourage you that if you want a fellowship, that's great, but do so outside, because it's just safer to be outside to share that socializing time and that fellowship time. But please do that on the outside. Also, just to let you know, and especially the chairpersons or the leaders of groups, our fellowship hall, Georgetown Hall, has been available for a while now. So I encourage you to, if you haven't, to start up your meetings again. If you go with the regularly scheduled meetings, that's great. Georgetown Hall is what we're using, and there are specific guidelines for that as well. So if you are a leader or a chairperson, please send me an email or a text, and I can send you that list of what we need to do in order to be following the guidelines for that as well. But we need to be about the business of the church as well at this time. And so that's all that I have in ways of announcements. So let us begin our worship service. The first hymn is How Great Thou Art.
Yeah.
I go to my prayer, I forgot to mention that today is we will be celebrating Holy Communion. So for those of you who may be home, if you didn't remember that, or I encourage you to get some bread and some grape juice before we have that communion. And so now let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you, giving thanks for each day that you give to us. Lord, giving thanks and praise that we are able to gather once again in your house. And our purpose is to give praise and honor and glory to you as we come to worship you. It may not be how we are used to, but Lord, at least it is a step, it's a progression in the right direction. So anytime we gather and worship you, that is a good thing. So we thank you for that. Lord, continue to guide us and direct us as your people and as your church. May we continue to carry out those ministries that you have placed before us and do so with great joy, excitement, and enthusiasm, for indeed we serve a risen, living Savior. We thank you for this time, and we just bring all of these things before you in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Today's call to worship is taken from Psalm 148, verses 1 through 8, and I invite you to read this along with me in unison. Normally, we do responsive reading, but let us do this in reading in unison. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise the Lord in the heights. Praise the Lord, all his angels. Praise the Lord, all his host. Praise the Lord, sun and moon. Praise the Lord, all shining stars. Praise the Lord, highest heavens, and all waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, who commanded and they were created, who established them forever and ever, and fixed their bounds which cannot be passed. Praise the Lord from the earth, sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail and snow and smoke, a stormy wind fulfilling God's command. Amen. Okay, today I brought with me an ice cube tray, and some of you may not know what this is, because maybe your refrigerators have the ice maker that's in there, and if you have a real nice fancy one, you may not even have to open up the door to get the ice. You just push a little button, and you put your glass under there, and the ice comes and fills it up. But we have a refrigerator, and it's a new refrigerator. It just doesn't have the ice maker in it. So we have actually four trays that we put in our freezer part of our refrigerator. And so you fill this with water. Now, if you want to have some real fun and have a treat, fill it with, you know, like juice of some kind, and it could be like a popsicle, but that's not my message today. So, and make sure you get permission for those of you who need permission to do that. But I like, even though our water is cold, or if we have iced tea, it's cold, but I just like ice cubes extra in my glass. So we have to put water in here in each of these little cubicles and put them in the freezer compartment. Now, I can't just get it out a half hour later because it may not be frozen at all. So there, you have to wait. There's patience and the water to freeze and become ice. And even if you wait, you think, long enough, and you take them out and you pop it, the top may be frozen, but the rest may not be, so you're just going to have a mess. So we have to wait. There's patience in that, but good things come to those of us who wait, and so we need to do that. And so what I want to talk about is there's patience all through life. I had some examples, and I'll share them, but I think what comes to my mind now is the biggest thing that all of us have to have had and still need to have patience for is this whole coronavirus thing that we are in the midst of. I know some believe it's just a figment of somebody's imagination or whatever. I'm not going there. I personally think it's real. You tell all of those folks whose loved one has passed away from this virus and tell them it's not real. But anyway, I don't want to get into the political part of it. But we've been having to wait and wait and wait. Now, there's restrictions have been lifted little by little, and I think very cautiously, very smartly. We are here. It may be 6 months since we were here last, but we are here. So we are progressing. But we have to wait. And I know, at least sometimes, patience isn't a thing that I'm good at. And I've learned a long time ago, somebody says, well, pray for patience. No, I don't do that. Because I'm concerned God's going to say, okay, wait. You know, be careful if you pray for patience, because God may say, I'm going to make you wait a while for that. But I know even when we go into a fast food, you know, area, why don't they already know what I want, you know? And no, we don't phone ahead. I know folks can do that, but we don't phone ahead. But they ought to know that I want, you know, item number one, and I want this drink, and I want this size. Why do I even have to wait in those lines? Or, you know, younger children especially. And I don't want to rush the seasons. We're just now coming into fall, and I love the autumn time of the year. But especially during Advent time and coming up to Christmas time, you tell little ones to wait, you know, for Christmas Day, and they're going like, is it here yet? Is it here yet? You know, they do that forever. Or even going on a trip, are we there yet? And you just pulled out of the driveway. But we all need to learn patience. And Jesus talks about, you know, patience and those kind of things in the Bible. So patience is an important thing. Good things will come to us when we have patience when we wait. Now, also, as Christians, having patience or waiting doesn't mean we just sit around and twiddle our thumbs or play games on our devices, on those kind of things, until something happens. No, as Christians, we are to be actively doing things, but still wait for that event or wait for that situation to come to us. And it also, as I said before, may not come when we want it or when we expect it, but patience actually can be a good thing. So I need to practice what I'm preaching, and I need to be better at my patience and a lot of things, but I think all of us could use patience. So thanks for joining me, and let us do our prayer together. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me and showing me how to love others. Amen. We move now into our time of joys and concerns. And I invite you, after each item is shared, to say, Lord, hear our prayer. It's the beginning of a new school year. Very odd, very different, but the beginning of a new school year. Lord, hear our prayer. A great joy, Becky shares that there's a new grandson, Oakley, who was born on August 27th. Lord, hear our prayer. For our local church leadership, Lord, hear our prayer. For Maryland, going into phase 3, including Frederick County, and I'm not sure how many other counties, but we have moved to phase 3. Lord, hear our prayer. Now, we all just need to behave and let us stay in phase 3 and go beyond as well. Now, turning to concerns, we need to lift up the family. Cindy W., her dad passed away recently, so we need to remember the family and friends of her dad. Lord, hear our prayer. Also, we need to keep Jerry in our prayers as he continues to have health issues and concerns. Lord, hear our prayer. Also, for the family and friends of Ruth, who passed away recently. Lord, hear our prayer. For Sarah and her husband, who are moving to Kentucky to begin a brand new chapter of retirement. Lord, hear our prayer. We continue to lift up Allison as she goes through chemo treatments and the continued therapy. In her process. Lord, hear our prayer. For Isabel, as she begins rehab from a difficult back surgery. Lord, hear our prayer. For all of those who have missed work because of the virus or for other reasons, and also we need to remember those who are working so much overtime and working such long hours because of the virus. Lord, hear our prayer. Let us turn to the Lord in this time of prayer and reflection. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come again before you, giving thanks and praise for all that you are and all that you do in our lives. Lord, truly may we have the patience that is needed in order to see your goodness come to fruition. Lord, we thank you for the celebrations that have been mentioned. And Lord, we lift up those who are hurting this day, either because of physical concerns, spiritual situations, financial concerns, whatever that may be. Some have lost jobs, some are underemployed, and some just don't seem to get a break for any kind of rest because of what their job entails and working so many long hours. But Lord, may we understand it and know that ultimately you are in control. You are in charge. We just need to understand that. And Lord, we ask also that you continue to have a strong presence in our leaders' lives of this nation and also of the world. And as we are now, I guess, in the thick of the presidential process here in the States, we know there's so many things that are not healthy. There are things and there are words that are said that are not uplifting. And Lord, it isn't just in the leadership, But so many times and so many places, there's such negativity. And if we just would stop and reflect and think that things can happen better, we can work together better when there is more positive outlook on things, and stop trying to tear each other down, but rather we should build each other up. So, Lord, may we all be mindful of that. Lord, we pray for our conference, and as we head into our annual conference this coming Saturday by virtual means, Lord, may those things that are discussed and passed in our conference all bring honor and glory to you. Lord, we seek your guidance and wisdom in these times and at all times. Lord, be with those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, whether it's from the coronavirus situation or through other situations in their lives. Just undergird them with your grace and your peace. And we bring all of these things before you in Jesus' precious and holy name, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." You to follow along. Remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, "They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever." Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession to the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers, for their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. This is God's holy word for God's people, and we all say, Amen. As we just heard at the beginning of this passage, the Apostle Paul makes the contrast, makes a comparison between sowing sparingly, which we will reap sparingly, to that of sowing generously, in which we reap generously. Now, I don't know any farmer who would intentionally sow few seeds. There's just too much work, too much expense for them to purposely just scatter or plant a few seeds. But if that would be the case, then certainly it would be a sparse harvest. But the seeds that are sown in abundance, the expectation is of a bountiful harvest. Now, we need to understand that Paul's comments are not limited to crops, but the same principles apply to all aspects of our life. One example that I came up with of giving generously and producing blessings, and I'm not just talking about money, but is the covenant that a person or people make when they are being received into a local church congregation of the United Methodist Church. One question that I, as the pastor, ask that person or persons, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? And their response is, I will. In other words, what I'm asking is, will that person or those people be fully committed, sowing generously, if you will, by actively being involved in the life and in the well-being of the church to the glory of God? This same level of commitment and dedication should be the norm when anyone accepts Christ as their Lord and Savior. Spiritually speaking, the more we participate in the work of the Lord and do so generously and with a cheerful attitude, the more fruits, the more blessings that will come our way. Now, we need to understand that we don't give or we don't do to receive heavenly rewards, like some stores entice shoppers to make sure you use your bonus rewards to get that special deal. That's not what it's about. It is by our faith. It's not by our actions. We get these rewards. We get these blessings. This covenant that I just mentioned above also is not limited to those who are what I call official members of the church, but anyone who is a part of the body of Christ and claim a particular faith community as your church. And of course, here I'll use our church, Walkersville United Methodist Church, as an example. But everyone should be living by the same standards of being involved and producing generously for the glory of the Lord. The greatest encouragement for giving is that it pleases the Lord. Why is it then that sometimes we Christians need an encouragement to give when God has given us so much already? Everyone has commitments. I understand that. It's a way of life. God, family, work, school, whatever they are, and there's a large list of commitments that we all have. As Christians, then, it should be part of our lives, part of something we do to include church and making regular, consistent commitments, financial and otherwise. I remember my dear mom, she had a book that she kept as her budget. And Dad got paid every 2 weeks. And at the top of the list, Mom always had church. She knew what Dad's salary was going to be, and she made sure that 10% of that tithing, went to church, and then all of the other bills that were there. And it worked. We may not have had lots left over, but we weren't destitute. We weren't out on the street or whatever. And now, for me, it took a little while to understand and to realize it really does work. Because, see, I did the other process. I had all my other bills, and then I had church, if I had anything left over for church. I guess hopefully growing in my faith and getting conviction, I too then put it at the top of the list, and the blessings were there. Again, maybe not having a whole lot left over, but there always seemed to be enough to get through. Well, that's just one example. I mean, our church, this physical structure, and the organization we call Walkersville United Methodist Church relies completely on the generosity of each person to give faithfully, regularly, and to understand that, there again, I'm not just talking about money, but I'm talking about all of those commitments of time and talents and witness. Yes, the church is a living entity, but it cannot sustain itself. I remember in one of my appointments, the financial treasurer would say, every time we worked up the yearly church budget, and we had X amount of dollars as the bottom line, and she would always say, okay, see that line? You know how much we have and prepared for that? Zero. There's no magical pot of money sitting somewhere that says, okay, now we have $100,000 or $200,000 or whatever to pay all of these bills. She says, it needs to come from within the congregation, from the members and those who support the church. And she would remind us that every single year, but it stuck with me, and it's true. We come up with a budget, and we're quickly working on our budget for 2021. So we need to understand that. But there again, I'm talking being faithful, regular in our commitments in all of those areas. The church is totally dependent on each of us to contribute our time and our talents and our witness. I don't think I'm going to embarrass anybody, but for a great example, Nancy shares her talents as she plays the organ and plays the piano, and we enjoy that. And for those of you at home can't see John, but he's up in our balcony, and he is just trying to take care of all kinds of things up there and running all kinds of things. But that's just two examples. There are so many people behind the scenes that makes the church work, that makes the church function. And thanks be to all of us who participate and do. And we say, well, gee, I don't have a lot of gifts or a lot of talents. Well, we all have at least one. God says he gives us all at least one. So we need to be using them. You know, are we going to store it away for a rainy day? That's another illustration that a young person shared at my, I guess I shouldn't identify it, but another appointment that I had. The grandmother said, well, we need to be careful. We don't want to be spending too much money because we need to save it for a rainy day. And the granddaughter said, Grandma, have you looked lately? It's pouring rain. And she didn't mean physically raining, but she meant those concerns were already there. You know, so we can't just keep putting away. We need to be using our gifts and our talents and our skills that God has given to us. The church has commitments and obligations just like we do, responsibilities for services rendered and for items that need to be paid for. Generous giving of all of us keeps the church operational 24/7, 365. Whether we're inside or not, there are still expenses. There are still things that need to be done. trimming bushes and all kinds of things. I knew I need to be careful not to mention things because then I'll leave someone out and someone will go, well, he didn't mention what I did. Okay, get a grip. I appreciate you all when you're doing things, whether I mention it or not. But it's everyone's support and participation that allows us to not just survive, but to thrive and to grow as God calls us to go and to do. Well, the Apostle Paul lays out principles for us to follow to receive blessings. We're told in verse 7, each person should give what they have decided in their heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So the way we're doing offering, you drop it off when you come in, but if we pass the plate, you know, some people might go, ooh, you know, you almost have to pry their hands apart for it to drop in there. No, that's not what we're supposed to do. Or even in our time and our service that we give. Just think about when we do something for someone else and without them asking, how do we feel? We feel blessed. That person feels blessed. And that's what a cheerful giver is. Blessings come as a result of helping someone and also from the one who has helped that person, the one receiving the help and the one giving the help. So when we give generously from the heart, we live out God's commands and Jesus' teachings. Luke 6:38 tells us, give and it will be given to you. We can never outgive God. Giving is not what we do, rather it's what of who we are as Christians. Giving is not what we do, but giving is who we are as Christians. And understanding God's grace in our lives and wanting to pay it forward. Receiving God's blessing is one of the fringe benefits. The more all of us are scattering those seeds of goodwill, the greater the harvest of souls can be reached and affected in a positive way. Jesus says in Matthew 9:37, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And then in John 4:35, he says, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Again, Jesus isn't talking about the soybeans or the corn that's in the fields. He's talking about souls that are lost, unbelievers, those who don't know about Jesus yet or haven't committed their lives to Christ yet. He's saying that those souls are ripe for harvest. He's also saying that the workers are few, too few, willing to get involved in the nitty-gritty of life. But those souls that are ripe for the harvest, they will either come to know Christ because someone took the time to talk with them and to build a relationship with them, or those souls will fall into Satan's hand, to Antichrist's hands, because someone of that thinking got to them first. There are so many people just hungering and thirsting for something. They may not know what it is, so sometimes it's a matter of who gets to them first. We need to be getting to them first. We also need to break that age-old mindset of, let someone else do it. Well, that's the preacher's job. That's what he gets paid for, after all. But you know, we all need to do our part as God and Jesus commands us. And when we all work together for the common good of serving the Lord and serving others, those many issues, and trust me, many churches have the very same issues that we are dealing with, those concerns will disappear or greatly lessen, like lack of money, getting young people and children and families involved in the life of the church, reaching out to the unchurched, being involved in our neighborhood, and the list goes on. When we are obedient, when we do joyfully and cheerfully, sowing seeds generously, those things won't be near as prominent and may just completely go away. Well, I've already been walking on dangerous territory. I understand that. So I just might as well just get all the way in. We need to do away with the crippling attitude of few workers doing the majority of the work. Or the mindset, well, remember back when we had, we aren't there anymore. Today is our reality. So we need to be sowing generously and have an action plan, and that will determine our future. I'm not saying it's negative to look back, but I think it's also in scriptures that if you keep looking back, and there again, I'll use a farmer, since we live on a working farm and this area is so rich with farmers and farmland, if that farmer constantly kept looking back where they were working, well, I'd love to see that pattern when they're sowing those seeds or during the harvest. They're going to miss most of it. They're going to be scattered all over the place. So we look back once in a while briefly, but we don't want to keep looking back at those things. And maybe that's what this whole coronavirus, one thing that has done is maybe forced us to look at how can we do things differently, maybe even more effectively, maybe more efficiently. I'm going to need a life preserver if I keep on. But I think it's necessary for us to reflect upon those things. Well, our generosity will meet needs. If there's a need to be met, grace-filled Christians will do what we can to meet that need. I learned way early on that if church members don't like debts, if there's a debt, miraculously and wonderfully, mysteriously, resources appear to take care of those debts. If there's a need that arises in the community, we are at the front of the line to help out. Our mission projects are well supported financially, and that just is a great testament to the generosity of many people. Our giving will glorify God. We glorify God by our obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ and by the generosity of our sharing with others. The great thing about giving, no one person, no one individual should receive the glory. That belongs to God. Our giving will unite us as God's people. With the right attitude, joyfully and generously, we are part of a greater whole. We are unified as witnesses to God's love and his grace. When we practice grace giving, we first give ourselves to the Lord. Then we give what we have. Our gift is a symbol, a surrendering of our heart. Well, hopefully this gives us a little better understanding about blessings of giving generously. And trust me, I just scratched the surface. But my encouragement is, may we all have an attitude of sowing generously for God's glory. The result will always be God will bless us abundantly in all things. To God be the glory. Amen. And now I invite you to be prepared with an attitude and also with your elements as we get ready to celebrate Holy Communion. Those of you who are here should have received your little packet. The wafer is on top, and then, of course, the grape juice is on the bottom. So just be careful when you peel back those layers. And for those of you at home, hopefully you have your bread and your juice ready as well. I will share parts of the litany of communion, but I don't have parts for you to respond to, just being a little harder to do a whole lot of speaking with your mask on. But listen to these words. Christ, our Lord, invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, we will confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. And this is the good news, the great news, that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, that proves his love towards us. If you want to get your wafer prepared, I invite you to do that. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to God, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out, O Lord, your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and for those who are watching, and on these gifts of bread and wine. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with God, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. So take and eat the bread. And take and drink the juice. I just will share a little concern. I asked a colleague, it's like, doing communion this way, is this, you know, a proper way to do communion? And he didn't really have an answer for me. He says, "I know it's very awkward. It's very strange. I'm glad to see that you all did take your mask off to eat your bread and drink your juice. I figured you could figure that out. But I see you're readjusting your mask, so..." But I guess the way that I am comfortable with this is because God's blessing doesn't know boundaries, doesn't have limitations. So I still feel that the elements are blessed, and that we receive this sacred sacrament in that understanding that God's presence is with us, and it is in remembrance and in celebration that we partake in communion. Thanks be to God. I believe now we have another hymn for us to reflect upon, or a recording.
Why should I feel discouraged?
And I know he watches me.
go with this understanding and this grace and this peace that God loves us with all of his being. He wants us to serve him, but he also wants us to share the good news of Jesus Christ today and always. So go with his blessings and receive the joy and the excitement that only he can give to us this day and always. Amen. Thank you.